Good evening, dear viewers. Welcome back to the Diplomatic Talk program. In this episode, we are going to discuss diplomatic relations between the United Kingdom and Uzbekistan. But before we proceed, let's explore the United Kingdom. The UK is made up of 4 different countries, England, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, combined to make up the United Kingdom. While each country has its own level of autonomy, the term UK refers to all 4 together. The London Underground, or Tube as it is referred by locals, is the oldest underground railroad system in the world. Starting life in 1863, the underground system of London continues to develop this day. Initially featuring steam locomotives, the system was fully electrified in the early 20th century. The Tube is considered a tourist attraction within its own right and carries up to 5 million passengers a day. England has produced some of the best-known poets, novelists and playwrights in the world. Wherever your trip takes you across the country, you can explore the landscapes and ideas that inspired so many great works. For example, travel to the Lake District in northwest England to delve into the home of the romantic poets. Here among sublime mountains and lakes, William Wordsworth wrote lyrics in praise of the natural world. Near Hagsworth, you can explore Beatrix Potter's cottage. Hilltop surrounded by colorful gardens. One of England's major historical events that changed the world forever was the Industrial Revolution. Back in the 18th century, factories popped up across the country, cities grew, and life was transformed beyond the recognition. Soon this change spread to mainland Europe and beyond, but England is where it all began. As one of the biggest urban and overpopulated area in the world, the British capital is a melting pot of nations, cultures and therefore interesting facts. The city is the home to more than 8 million citizens who do communicate using different languages. It is estimated that there are more than 300 different languages spoken in London.
Now let's move to relations between Uzbekistan and Britain. Currently, Timothy Smart heads the diplomatic mission of Britain in Uzbekistan, while Ravshan Usmonov holds the position of ambassador of Uzbekistan in the UK.
The bilateral relations between Uzbekistan and the United Kingdom have witnessed a significant shift from standalone country-focused programs to regional initiatives. This strategic move has aimed to foster effective governance, economic development, climate resilience, and sustainable growth in the Central Asia region. One of the biggest programs in Central Asia, Effective Governance for Economic Development Program. Under it, the UK has allocated a budget of £25 for the period of 2020 to 2025. The primary objective of this initiative is to enhance the effectiveness, accountability, and transparency of economic policy delivery in Uzbekistan and the broader region. By focusing on selecting reform priorities, this program seeks to facilitate improved economic governance and policy implementation. The next program is called the Climate, Energy and Water Security for Central Asia region. With a budget of £19.5 million, the CEWCA program spans from 2024 to 2030. Its overarching goal is to further develop Central Asia's resilience and sovereignty by promoting low-carbon and climate-resilient growth across the region. Through strengthened regional cooperation, this initiative aims to address challenges related to climate change, energy security, and water resource management, thereby fostering sustainable development in Uzbekistan and neighboring countries. UK Central Asia Green Inclusive Growth Fund has committed £18 million to the UK Central Asia Green Inclusive Growth Fund, which will operate from 2024 to 2029. This program focuses on improving the capacity of small and medium-sized enterprises and increasing the flow of green investment finance in Central Asia. By supporting sustainable and inclusive economic growth, this initiative aims to drive positive change in Uzbekistan's business landscape and promote environmentally friendly practices. Furthermore, the UK contributes £10 million to support the Global Partnership for Education in Uzbekistan from 2023 to 2027. This program aims to improve access to and the quality of early childhood education, thereby promoting human capital development and equitable educational opportunities.
So right now we are at the British Embassy in Tashkent, and today with us His Excellency Ambassador Timothy Smart. Hello.
Gully, thank you so much for interviewing me today. It's a real pleasure to be here.
Thank you for agreeing for this interview. So my first question is, how long you've been working in diplomatic mission?
So we were just talking about this. I started my career as a diplomat in 1999, so come to 25 years. And since then, I worked at OSCE. I've been lecturing monitoring in Kyrgyzstan in 2000. I've been in Israel-Palestine. I've been in Basra. I've been in the Solomon Islands, Fiji. I was 5 years ambassador in Madagascar. And I've worked on communication. I've worked on policy, particularly EU in the Middle East. And now I am incredibly lucky to be His Majesty's Ambassador to Uzbekistan, which is an absolute dream role.
So many countries. So, like, how many countries have you already visited?
Oh, I've already worked in five countries on full-time postings, this being my fifth. And I hope to do some more. But at the moment, and for the next few years, I'm really, really happy to be here in Uzbekistan, because what a moment to be in your country. Yangi Uzbekistan, the reform agenda. Foreign Secretary visit last week, the first in 27 years, and he came back again 4 days later to meet with His Excellency Foreign Minister Saidov. And at this moment, as we look at your country's growing independence, sovereignty, territorial integrity, the prosperity, the growth of your population, it's a country that we see as so important. And your history, my goodness, Samarkand, Khiva, Bukhara, Fergana, Nukus, all these great places to go and have a look at. What's not to like? And the welcome has been amazing.
I see. So in those countries, have you faced any cultural cultural shocks? I mean, those countries are very different from each other.
So there were some nice things, yeah, very different. In Solomon Islands, it was a country where a lot of focus was development and climate change assistance, mm-hmm. Which had been a British protectorate, not colony. And I learned some lovely English words, pidgin English words. The word for helicopter is whirly whirly bird, which is brilliant. The word for crocodile is puck puck, which is a bit strange. In Fiji, I got told I was too skinny to be a high commissioner. I must get fatter to be a person of importance, which was a bit shocking, but quite interesting. In Madagascar, I learned some really nice things in diplomacy. In that culture, and it's really nice, you can have a discussion with someone and you can disagree. Mm-hmm. The second you shout, you've lost the argument, whatever you're saying. And it's a really wonderful culture, because if you're in a culture where people shout a lot, maybe Mediterranean culture where it's quite normal, sure. You've got to be really careful to be quite reserved in how you speak. Because if you shout, uh-huh. The whole audience will lose your message.
Oh, really?
Now, I'm not naturally a shouty person, so that's okay. But if you come from a culture where it's normal to express yourself loudly and forcibly, mm-hmm. you're going to not engage with that whole population easily.
I see. Very interesting. What about Uzbekistan? What was like a different thing from the other countries, or something like unique?
So I was, despite the language training, despite the reading, despite talking to, I was talking daily to a teacher in Samarkand, I had an Uzbek teacher in London, nothing prepared me for the pace of reform here, for the sheer growth and development of your country, for the level of English and the thirst for English language education. Until you're here and you see the prosperity and the growth and the aspiration to be the leader of Central Asia, to make sure that what you do brings security and stability to your whole region. And not just that, you're looking overseas to what's happening in Afghanistan, you're looking what's happening in Iran, and you're looking to Southeast Asia. You're in a difficult geographic area. Mm-hmm. You know this area better than anyone else, and learning from you how to do that. So your diplomacy and your culture are quite interesting to me. Your culture, because you're welcome, your khush kalabsiz, the focus on the mehmon, on the guest, is something truly wonderful and remarkable. Now, I've seen it with Palestinians and Bedouin in the West Bank in Palestine, mm-hmm. that wonderful welcome, but I never got to stay a long time. Mm-hmm. I've been here since August, well, now 8 months, 8-9 months, and still that welcome continues, that sheer desire to work, not to work together, to find solutions.
Yeah.
Not to take sides, but really to focus on what's best for your population. And I love how much you celebrate your history, how much your cities, those ancient centers of learning, Bukhara and Samarkand, just that sheer history. When my country was going through a bit of a darker age, mm-hmm. your country was shining the light on education and science and culture. Mm-hmm. Really quite remarkable. And not just doing it, you know, in the 14th and 15th centuries, but doing it for 1,500 years longer before then. Really wonderful and remarkable. And I also was an ancient historian. I quite like the fact that Iskander got up here as well. It's quite interesting to me.
You studied ancient history?
Ancient history. So I studied a lot of what would be a Greek, Roman, and a bit of Persian history up until about 1000 AD. Mm. So this is truly a center of that.
Yes, I see. Yes, you've mentioned about the countries, and then I remembered your first interview. It was in 2023 when you first arrived, and you've been speaking in Uzbek language. That was so amazing, you know. So many people were happy to see it, and I was like, he was prepared before coming here. And did you learn Uzbek language?
So bugün men Uzbek tilida organi yapman, men gapirishim kerak. Juda Uzbek tilida juda muhim, juda qiziq menga. But I must practice more, and I love it. It's because it you get to know the culture.
Yes.
Better. You get to look for uzaro manfaatli in the work as a diplomat. Finding that mutual benefit is really important to us. It's the core of what I do. But more than that, when we were thinking about the visit of the Foreign Secretary last week, we also looked at options to celebrate your culture and your language. And of course, I'd have explored some texts by Alicia Navoi. Mm-hmm. And so instantly when I was speaking to colleagues at Oxford University, they said, oh, we have some first editions of Alicia Navoi, which maybe we could do something as a gift between the Foreign Secretary and the Foreign Minister and His Excellency, the President or Representative. And that was great because I could understand how important that was for Uzbekistan to go back to the original works in Chagatai and into building into your national poet. Absolutely wonderful.
That was great. And, you know, this interview was very unique. I do remember it. But let's move to your childhood. As a child, have you ever thought, like, one day you will become a diplomat and represent your country?
So it's a good question. I knew of diplomacy from a young age because one of my grandfathers had worked in as a district commission for the British government in what was Tanganyika, is now modern-day Tanzania. And not only had he been a district commissioner, but he'd also been a headmaster, set up one of the first schools. And in that school, he'd taught half his students. The students, some of them became in the first cabinet of independent Tanzania. In fact, he taught half of the first government, cabinet government in Tanzania. And both of my grandparents had been members of the Royal Air Force during the Second World War, taking on the Nazi Germany. So I grew up on these stories of sacrifice and public service and how important it is. And from my paternal grandfather's experience in Tanzania, I knew about diplomacy from him, and it always it grew in me a love of history. And so from then on, anytime I looked at anything to do with history, I devoured history books, and I just want to learn more about different communities, different cultures. And that is a really good foundation for wanting to be a diplomat.
If I'm not mistaken, right now you are collaborating in terms of education, right?
Yeah.
It's a training program. And trade, right?
Yeah.
What kind of programs or projects in this sector?
Thank you. So when I got here, so trade is too small between our countries. When I got here, it was about £230 million. I've got an excellent Department of Business Trade team here, led by a regional director, and they doubled that. To 470 million, but I think we should be on at least a billion soon. That's what we want to be driving. His Excellency, the Deputy Prime Minister, Kuchkarov, met Lord Cameron, the Foreign Secretary, and they, on the back of a joint declaration signed with the Foreign Minister between Britain and Uzbekistan, looking to enhance our partnership across trade, climate, economy, security, counter-terrorism, and in various areas. Part of that was this economic piece. And at the heart of that, we're exploring areas where we can help on infrastructure. Mm-hmm. We have £3.6 billion worth of UK export financing dedicated to Uzbekistan to help with infrastructure and wider projects. And within that, we're looking to partner ideally with the government of Uzbekistan and our companies on the second high-speed rail link to Samarkand from Tashkent. That'd be wonderful if we can make that happen, and we've got teams working on that. We are supporting Uzbekistan's WTO accession, and we have begun negotiations between the UK and Uzbekistan to make that happen.
Great. What about the tourism sector?
Oh, tourism, absolutely. Whenever anyone comes here, I love Tashkent. I hope to be an honorary Toshkentlik by the time I leave here. But obviously, your government's focus on tourism to the country is really important. And I met one of your tourism ambassadors, Sophie Ibbotson, very first person I met in country, who back in the UK works with the Uzbek embassy there to sort of promote. There's a lot more we can do. And we want to see many tens of thousands of British tourists coming and sampling this incredible country.
10,000.
We want tens of thousands.
Oh, okay.
We want tens of thousands. And, you know, more flights to the UK, more regularly flights. Great that Uzbekistan Airways is doing 3 flights a week. We should make sure that more people are coming and we're doing more flights. And we should make that regular. And if you want other companies coming here to help, let us know. We can always put you in contact with some of those companies who might be able to come here as well.
Great. And what areas of cooperations are promising for Uzbekistan? What do you think?
Oh my goodness, so many. What do I see as promising? Your digital growth, the digiparks you've got are truly world-leading, and the way you've got the tax incentives, the way you're focusing on dormitories and universities next to them to help your young come through and establish these jobs, really brilliant. I love the fact you've gone and looked at what's happening in Singapore or in India, how they're doing, and taken the best and brought that back. So you skip a whole process of building these things and go right to leading edge. Really impressive. Lots more of that. Your agricultural sector, truly amazing. When I finish my time in Uzbekistan, not be able to have your melons in the summer will be really sad because they are so wonderful. Whether it's the infrastructure, whether it's the mining. I think I'm in my second week here, I went to Al Malik mine and saw this huge copper production. Largest open cast mine in the world, 550,000 tons. And then you had what was called a waste product, which the 55,000 tons, which the rest of the world call that waste product gold. Mm-hmm. And that's not even your largest mine. And you have critical minerals. So if we can help you and with others access those critical minerals, so essential for new technologies around the world, that's something we're also actively exploring. And at the same time, we're very conscious that your economy like ours is too carbon dependent. What can we do to work together to help your governments on its greening of the economy agenda? We've got lots of expertise in Britain where we would like to share and help you reach your 2030 goals to reducing carbon emissions. That's something I think we can do a lot of partnership, and that helps you and it helps us both economically and the world we live in.
I read a report from the World Bank. It was saying that by 2030, Central Asian countries will face severe problems with the water, and it will bring tension between countries. So, as the ambassador who have been in so many countries, and of course you saw different problems in different countries, what do you think? How can we resolve the problem with the water?
So on one level, what you're doing now is absolutely right. You have regional mechanisms. You're talking to each other, mm-hmm. and you all accept there's a need for sharing the water. And that's why Kosh Tepa, you don't have that trilateral agreement, and there's an interim government who you can't sign international agreements with because it's not recognised with. So we understand that difficulty. So you've got the work that since the end of 2016 that President Mirziyoyev has been leading in working with his regional counterparts and government to government links, we would encourage more of the Central Asia 5 format. But we realise that you have other neighbours in that who you need to be talking to in terms of water resources. At the same time, there's kind of the technical bit. How much water is lost through broken pipes? How much water is lost through evaporation because of inefficient irrigation systems? What does that look like? Are there countries in the world who have less water loss in their irrigation? Can we help you partner with those? Can we look at development funding to help you with that, or bring private partnerships together to help with that? What in terms of what more can we do in terms of what sort of crops are you doing? I met some Uzbeks academics back in Cambridge University mm-hmm. who are exactly looking at the type of resilience you have to . The crops you can plant if temperatures reach here 50 degrees for a sustained period. What does that look like? So bringing some of the top experts from something like the Cavendish Laboratory at Cambridge, but across the UK with expertise, looking at what the world looks like and how we feed ourselves in a much warmer world. What does that look like? So we share that experience already. What more can we do? So it's the political will you're doing. It's kind of the technical agreements. You're doing a lot of that. Can we help? Then it's around the technology and the expertise and partnerships, again, where we can help government to government links, but we can also help bring some of that British business, but also research expertise, to the really latest knowledge and understanding to work in partnerships with yourself to help.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. This was my last question. Would you like to add something?
No. Suslaringis, Dusalaringis, Uchun Katarakmat.
Thank you for you. Thank you for this amazing interview. That was a pleasure to talk to you.
For me, the pleasure is all mine. Thank you.
Thank you for watching our program and joining us on this diplomatic journey. Stay tuned for our next episodes.